The original Persona 5 was my favorite game of 2017 and also one of the best, if not the best, JRPG I have ever played. It had it all: an engaging story, great graphics, top-notch voice acting, a fantastic soundtrack, amazing turn-based combat, content surpassing over 100 hours, and lastly, an overabundance sense of style. From the menus, to the loading screens, to the character portraits, Persona 5 didn't fail at impressing you at all times. I can definitely say that Persona 5 left me a big impression. It's a game that I would always use as the highest standard when I'm comparing RPGs. It was just that good, and I'm not the only one who thinks so. If you go at Metacritic, you will see that this has a score of 93, which is really difficult for a game to achieve, and especially for a Japanese and niche game like Persona 5. Gamers and critics loved it. You would always hear good things about the game and how you should play this amazing new game called Persona 5. It's almost as like the Persona series became mainstream at that point. Persona 5 was the game that made the Persona series known to the West. Hell, Joker is now everywhere. He even got a spot in Super Smash Bros., which boosts the game's popularity even more. At that point, Persona 5 is a huge success and a highly regarded game by everyone. So, how do you improve a game that is already close to being perfect? Well, let me break that down for you with my review of Persona 5 Royal. Anyone who's familiar with the Persona series knew that Royal was coming. Similar with Persona 4 Golden and Persona 3 FES, Persona 5 Royal is the re-release of Persona 5 with updated visuals, quality of life improvements, new characters, new story, a new soundtrack and finally updated gameplay. So Persona 5 R is essentially Persona 5 but more of it. I cannot lie, I had my concerns when I first about the release of Royal. The reason for that was that I thought that this time they would give you the option to upgrade your original copy like an expansion instead of charging full price for it. Atlus definitely treated Persona 5 R as a full new release. Back at the Persona 3 and Persona 4 era, updates and generally DLC didn't quite exist, so it was normal for developers to release upgraded versions of the original game. So for Atlus to do this, despite that, they will have to bring their A game, or else Persona 5 R would flop badly. To sum this up, when I buy a $60 re-release of a game I have already played, would have the highest expectations, so in return I'm going to be really strict while judging. So after playing Persona 5 R, I can definitely say with confidence that it's worth it. Not only that, it's absolutely spectacular. I had my doubts and Persona 5 R blew them away. So, if you were looking for a recommendation, go buy it. I don't care if you have already played the original, go buy it now. It's a must have if you like JRPGs and have a PS4. So, let's go in more detail at Persona 5 R's many different parts. I'm going to start with the graphics. Anyone who takes a look at Persona 5 can clearly see that it's overflowing with style. From the always animated menus, to the sleek character designs, to the creatively designed personas. It's a game that you will be able to play in years to come without looking outdated because of this art style. It also helps that the whole game is cel-shaded, giving it a really comic book art style and potentially hiding some of the inconsistencies that would look bad at other games. Persona 5 also does something unique in regard to how it designs their NPC characters. NPCs look really bland and low poly. A reason for that is to save on resources, of course, but as a result it makes the main characters pop out more. I think that is a cool way to depict and bring out the main characters, but I have to admit sometimes it breaks immersion. Persona 5 does a fantastic job making you feel like you are really in Japan, from packed with people metro stations to the beautiful back streets of Yongenjaya, and then going to the lively and vibrant streets of Shibuya. Every location feels authentic and created with attention to detail. If you have ever played any Yakuza game, then it's pretty much the same experience. Every main city is filled with things to do and see, like shops where you can buy items or gifts, restaurants where you can eat or work part-time, and even a cinema where you can watch movies with your friends. There's always something to do and see when you are roaming around. You can move from location to location through the use of the metro stations. In Persona 5R, there's a new location added called Kishijoji. Like with the previous areas, it's filled with things to do and see, including the addition of two new minigames, which are darts and billiards. I have to say, I really like the new area. You can expect new side quests and events when visiting. Other locations you can visit are the school, which you are going to spend a lot of your time, Café Le Blanc, which is the coffee shop where you will be staying, and finally some locations that you can only access if you invite the character with you. These locations are not explorable and play out only in cutscenes. Lastly, of course, we have the palaces, which are stunning. Compared to the other dungeons at the previous Persona games, these are handcrafted, making them feel really unique. Their design changes every time to patch the person it's based off, and it brings out their personality in every moment. There's many locations to see at Persona 5R, but what is the difference compared with the original regarding graphics? Most drastic changes I have noticed is the increase in resolutions and a lot of textures at the main game, especially to the clothes of the main characters wear. You can clearly see that they look more crisp compared to the original. Another one is the lighting and the colors are more vibrant. They definitely used warmer colors for P5R and it definitely shows. As a result, the original P5 feels washed out in comparison, which I find really surprising because I thought that it looked amazing when it came out. These upgrades must have happened because of the original P5 was supposed to be a PS3 game, so many elements from that port survive at the PS4 release as well. For Persona 5R, I think they fully taken advantage of the PS4's added horsepower. A thing I forgot to talk about is the new and updated character portraits for all the characters. They help bring those characters to life even more, and it's one of my favorite additions. Honestly, I'm a sucker for anime art style, so I was set to liking from the start. But Persona 5 attention to detail and style is noteworthy, even if it isn't right up your alley. Let's move on to sound. Everything is up to par here as well. For your information, I have played this with the Japanese dub because I think it suits to the game overall theme even better and for immersion reasons. But if you want to play this in English, go ahead. Both English and Japanese voice acting is phenomenal all across the board. The game is voice acted through the most part of its main story. Generally, I can say that all the important scenes are voice acted. When there's not voice acting, you are going to be reading text after text in classic JRPG fashion. This is reserved for the side quest, the side activities, meaning hanging out with your friends or speaking to a vendor to buy some items, these kind of things. Although, if an important moment comes to those side activities, there's actual voice acting again. So you can expect a fine balance of voice acting throughout the game. Now let's talk about the soundtrack, and oh my god, it's an amazing soundtrack. From the battle theme when you're fighting shadows at the metaverse to the relaxing tunes when you're living your life as a student. Soundtrack never fails to match the mood of what you're doing at the moment. In Persona 5R, they added even more tracks to the playlist, which I think it's crazy. They took a soundtrack that was already godly and upgraded it. I'm honestly astounded at that point. I really like the new battle theme Takeover, which I think is my favorite battle theme of all time. Persona 5R soundtrack is so good that I always have it playing at the background, so I ensure you're going to like it. Last part to talk about the sound design is the battle sounds. There's a really nice feedback depending on what you're doing at the screen. For example, if you do a magical attack, let's say an electric attack, you will hear the appropriate sound effect. The thing I like is that the more powerful the attack, the bigger the sound effect. It really helps you see and understand how powerful your characters are getting, and it's pretty usual stuff, not something that will blow you away, but pretty amazing nonetheless. Now, moving on to the story, just a warning, if you're sensitive about spoilers, you might want to skip this part, because I'm going to go over some story beats in order to talk about them. I will not spoil the new semester or the new story stuff, but I will talk about some specific moments of the game. So, light spoiler warning here. You have been warned, so if you're still here, let's start. You're playing as a mostly voiceless protagonist that you can name yourself. After you have been convicted wrongly for assault because you tried to save a woman from getting in all kinds of trouble, you get put on probation and forced to move into Tokyo. There you're going to stay for a year as a student, and you will be required to not get into any kind of trouble. You will be staying at LeBlanc, which is a coffee shop which is owned by a middle-aged man called Sojiro, who's also going to be your guardian for the year. It's really apparent from the start when you get there that you are an outcast because of your criminal past. That is especially apparent when you get to your new school, the Sujin Academy. Everyone knows what you supposedly done and they got nothing to do with you. This is really an interesting dynamic because if you compare it to the prologue of Persona 5, it's the exact opposite. Like, instead of moving from a big city to a remote town, you move from a remote town to a big city. And instead of being warmly welcomed, you get sand from the moment you get there. So, right off the bat, the game is trying to tell you that is way more serious than Persona 4. That's really the nice thing about the Persona games. Each game has its own theme, like Persona 3 had death as its theme and how to get over it. Persona 4 was accepting yourself, and Persona 5 theme is rebellion. Each theme is also represented by colors. Persona 3 has a cold blue, Persona 4 has a more warm yellow color, and finally Persona 5 is red and black. So you have an idea of the tone of the game by just looking at the UI. Continuing on with the story, after the protagonist tries to get at his first day at school, he meets a gorgeous blonde girl named Dan. After that, she gets inside the car of a sketchy teacher looking kind of sad. And then after that you meet best boy Ryuji. You learn that the teacher's name is Kamoshida and he is apparently involved in things like physical and sexual abuse. He's pretty much a pile of human trash. So after Ryuji tells you what's the deal with him, you both try to get at school, but instead of the school you find yourself at a giant castle. You go inside, then you are captured by the guards. After this you wake up in a cell with Ryuji, not knowing what is going on. Shortly after that, Kamoshida, the teacher, arrives, but he's in a king outfit looking, needless to say, he's looking kind of odd. So after that, he tries to kill Ryuji, and the feeling of rebellion and regret fills up the main protagonist, and he awakens to a new power, which is one of the coolest transformations of all time, in my opinion. This power is called the Persona, a manifestation of the user's psyche given form. From there on, you will battle your way out, but not before meeting Morgana, a cat that you can apparently talk, and also this cat can also summon a persona. He explains that you are inside the palace, which is a manifestation of the person's distorted desires, and the subconscious of the person is the king of the palace, commanding shadows that will try to kill everyone that invades. So after that you get back to the real world, you get to the school. You meet once again Kamoshida, which apparently already told everyone that you have a criminal record. As you're going through the first days at your school, you learn more about Kamoshida and how much of a jerk he is. He abuses his students, blackmailing them into doing things he wants, and even goes as far as to rape a student. That student's name is Siho and her friend is Anne, the previous girl that we saw at the start. And Anne tries to help her friend by befriending Kamoshida into living with her alone. But Kamoshida, being the jackass he is, he tries to get Anne to sleep with him. After learning all that, you go back at the palace with Ryuji and once again you meet Morgana. There he tells you that if you manage to steal Kamoshida's treasure in the Cognitar world, you can force him to have a change of heart by essentially stealing his desires. And that's what you are going to do. So after Ryuji awakens his persona as well, you go back to prepare for the operation. When you get back to the palace once again, Anne accidentally comes with you. So things happen and she awakens to her persona. And oh my god, I can't get enough of these transformations, they're brutal AF. So, the four of you will try to go through the palace to get the treasure, and you do. After finding the treasure, Morgana tells you that you will have to sell a calling card to the target at the real world in order for the treasure to manifest. So, you go back, send the calling card, and come back to steal the treasure. You fall to the trap of Kamoshida though, and he transforms to a hideous monster and tries to kill you. After you beat the shit out of him, he begs you to not kill him. Really ironic for someone like him, so Anne gets a little bit heated and almost kills him, but then she decides not to. She tells him that it will be a better punishment if he atones for his crimes. So the Sun Kamoshida returns to his real self and the palace starts collapsing. So you get back to the real world and now you just have to wait for the change of heart. When the day comes, Kamoshida confesses his crimes and he's filled with guilt for what he's done. That was a really nice conclusion to the first story. Now, the game will go pretty much that way. You find a target and a time limit to go with it, and you have to go in his palace and deal with him. And while you do, you're going to meet a lot of interesting characters along the way and add them to the party. The reason I went into detail about the prologue of the game is because I wanted you to tell you how the game story is structured. So, you will continue finding targets, going inside their unique palaces and getting more influence as the Phantom Thief of Hearts. It's a really compelling plot and the different stories that you see while playing are written in a very good way. It all comes back to the game's main theme, rebellion. And although it sounds kinda edgy when you're playing as a teenager, the game deals with some really mature themes and it's going with it in a really mature way. The game flows really well without tiring you out. There's always a new theme to explore and new motivations for the characters to keep moving on, and in result the pacing of the game is phenomenal. What can I say? I love the story in the origin and I also loved it here. Rogel tells the story of the Phantom Thieves again in a better way. More events have been added to flesh out the characters even more, and social links have been overhauled altogether, like Akechi. He's now a proper social link that doesn't auto-advances. I really liked that change because it fleshed out his character a lot more than the original. Except from the changes to the story, Royal has a whole more new story stuff with the inclusion of two new characters, a third new semester and two new endings. Honestly, these last parts of the story were amazing. I won't say anything more because I don't want to spoil you, but let me tell you this. You will have a lot of fun going through it. Also, the two new characters Maruki and Kasumi are so likable and I thoroughly enjoyed their addition to the story. Their addition felt really natural. If I hadn't played the original game, I wouldn't think that they're extra content. Last thing I wanna talk about is the story. It had the best palace in the game. You won't be disappointed, trust me. Atlus really gave everything they had at the new story content and I think it paid off. The only weird thing about the third semester is that it has unlocking requirements. They are not hard to complete per se, but if you don't know about them, you might just get the regular ending without getting to the third semester. I just think it shouldn't be something that you have to unlock if you're buying the same game twice. That's a really minor nitpick though, and it's no way hinder the game's enjoyment for me. So, to sum up about the story, I really loved it. It was as charming and well-paced as the originals, and with the new additions, they managed to expand the story that was already complete, and make it even more spectacular. Also, a tip from me, make sure to rank up Maruki and Akechi really early, it will be worth it. Moving on to gameplay. Persona 5 was the traditional turn-based affair, like many other JRPGs. The same is also for Royal. Persona 5 Royal's combat will have you attack enemies in a turn-based fashion. You can do physical attacks with your weapons, or you can try using your more powerful personas. You can also, of course, use healing items. Each party member has one persona and they're usually focused on a specific elemental attack. That is important because enemies have weaknesses and you will want to exploit these weaknesses. And that's where Persona 5 unique system is coming to. If you do manage to hit an enemy with an element that he's weak, then you can get an additional 10 for yourself. Pretty neat, right? A system that complements the weakness mechanic even more is the Baton Pass. Baton Pass allows you to pass your 10 to an ally after you hit an enemy's weakness. When you do, your teammate will get increased health and damage. Pass the baton enough times and the last baton pass will result into a powerful attack that will not cost you anything to perform. I'm so glad they reworked the baton pass, it's also now available right off the bat without the need to unlock it. So you can keep your enemies essentially from attacking you at all. That being said, the enemies can do the same thing to you, so keep that in mind. Another change to the combat is the gunplay. Guns in the original Persona 5 were average at best. You had a limited use for them because ammo was a really limited resource. Now though, ammo replenishes after each battle, so you can fill your enemies with holes without worrying about it. The last thing I want to talk about the combat is the new showtime attacks and a little bit about the all-out attacks. The all-out attacks can be performed after each enemy has been knocked down. These attacks are so flashy and stylish I cannot get enough of them, even after seeing them more than 200 times. There are some new ones that they added, like Futaba's, which I think it's really cool. Now, the meaty new additions are the showtime attack. They unlock as you progress through the story. They can activate when you are low in health or when you're about to finish an enemy. Each has a unique cinematic, including the two characters that they partake in. They're so charming and entertaining that, like with the all-out attacks, I don't get tired seeing them. They're one of my new favorite additions in Royals, and it looks like they put a lot of work and care into them. After playing Persona 5 Royal for hundreds of hours, I can definitely say with certainty that it's my favorite turn-based system of all time. Now let's talk about the Velvet Room. Having the right persona for the right job is important. The way that you can acquire new personas is by recruiting them or fusing them. Recruiting shadows was a thing since Persona 1, and I'm happy that they decided to bring this back. It definitely makes more sense than getting it randomly after each battle. Although I have to say, recruiting sometimes is annoying because you will have to answer questions that match the shadow's personality to get them, and the answers are not always that obvious. Although in Royal they added a hint that tells you the shadow's personality beforehand, so you will have a better chance at succeeding. Again, that's a small nitpick, and in the grand scheme of things, it doesn't really matter, because the best way to obtain personas is by fusing them. Fusing personas or demons has been a staple in the SMT and Persona series. By combining two or more personas, you can create more powerful ones. You can perform this fusion at the Velvet Room, which too has received some upgrades. You can still fuse and itemize personas, but now there's some new elements added to the mix. There's a new mechanic that is called Fusion Alert, can happen randomly after the third palace. This changes the Velvet Room's color from a calm blue to a menacing red. If you perform a fusion during this alarm, the fused persona will get better skills and its stats will increase. So, it's a fantastic way if you're planning on creating high level personas for the endgame. Another new addition are the challenge battles. You can challenge enemies with variable difficulty and earn rewards. I think it's a neat new addition and it's worth the trouble because the rewards are really worth it in my opinion. Another small addition is that you can fuse personas higher than your current level. Although you can get some really powerful personas early on, I wouldn't really recommend it because it will make the game really easy and that's not fun. That also applies with the legacy DLC personas. Avoid using them at the start because again it would make the battles end in a second. I mean, come on, you can summon Messiah Picaro at level 1 for free, like really? Generally, I'm really glad with how they overhauled the Velvet Room. There's even more personas to fuse now, and with the fusion alarm system, I have made some pretty powerful personas. Another thing I wanted to talk about are Mementos. Mementos is the randomly generated dungeon with many floors that change every time you visit. It's like the Tartarus dungeon from Persona 3. You can explore Mementos at your leisure, and it's a good way to farm some experience and money. Although, I have to say, it gets boring really fast. Apart from doing some requests, it didn't have anything more going for it. I'm glad to say that Royal addressed this and made some improvements. There's a new NPC added which is named Jose, where you can buy items with a new currency that is called flowers. But the most important thing you can do now is change the cognition of Mementos. By collecting stamps that you can find randomly while exploring Mementos, you can use them to level up your XP, money, and item drop rate. It's a fantastic way to maximize your farming in Mementos, and it also serves as an incentive to explore more. That made the pace of Mementos a lot better for me, and I was rarely bored. Upgrading my money gain, cutting my grinding time in half, and collecting flowers and stamps for Jose was always something I looked forward to. Also, Jose plays a bigger role in the story than he looks like, and I will leave it at that because I don't want to spoil you. Another new bonus is that we have more tracks to listen while exploring, which is always welcome. Now, let's talk about the palaces. Palaces are mostly the same, with some minor additions. You can now traverse the palaces a little bit faster with the addition of the grappling hook. You can expect to skip some areas to get quickly to your goal. Apart from that, you can use it to get to some new areas to find treasure, and more importantly, the other new addition that are the will seeds. Will seeds are hidden behind a giant door that you can find while exploring the palace. There are 3 of them at every palace, and every time you get one, you will recover some SP, which I think is pretty neat. To find those doors, you will have to explore a bit, but don't worry, because none of them are really easily missable. At the last door, there's always a powerful enemy to fight, so be prepared before venturing into him. After you gather all 3 of them, they combine into a new powerful accessory. If you give that to Jose, it can make it even better. They give you things like permanent skills and nullify weaknesses. They're insanely powerful items, so I suggest you always try to gather them every time you finish a palace. The last change at the palaces themselves is the last boss fights. You can expect to follow a different tactic than you did before, like Amoshida summons students to toss him balls and to damage you and your teammates, or Madarame summons multiple versions of himself. They fit into the person's character, and I really like this addition. There was one boss fight though, one boss fight that I absolutely hated, and that was the Okumura boss fight. It was bad at the original P5, but it is now even worse. Who thought it was a good idea to make the enemies respawn if you don't kill them all in one go? And every time you do it, it makes Okumura, he buffs them and debuffs you and respawns the enemy again. Also, he can randomly insta-kill you, making you start the battle all over again. I seriously think that is a badly designed battle that is neither fun or interesting. You don't even fight Okumura, you fight his robots. I can definitely say that was my biggest negative with Royal, and I hope they manage to fix it on an update. I suggest you use the DLC's personas for this fight because they help a lot. So that was it for the palaces overall. They streamlined them, made them even better with more things to fight and do. And as I said before, I absolutely love the last palace. You are in for a treat. Now let's move on to the last part of the video and the second half of the game. If you're at least a little bit familiar with the Persona games, then you know that the game is structured equally in 2 parts, the battling and dungeoning part and the high school student simulator. When you're not spending your time killing shadows and diving into people's palaces, you will be living your life as a high school student. That means you will take exams, go to school, hang out with your friends, work part-time jobs, have fun at your free time, and generally engaging in activities that a high schooler would. The activities you will engage totally depend on you. At every palace, you will be given a time limit, which is usually about a month. So you will have to complete the palace between that time. If you don't, it's essentially game over. If you do manage to complete the palace, let's say in 1 day, then the rest of the time you have left, you can engage on those activities I mentioned before. And why should you may ask? Can you just skip to the main story? Well, you could do that, but you will miss a whole lot of content. Every activity you do will raise your social stats, depending on what the activity entails. Social stats are useful for mostly one thing, and that is ranking up confidence. Confidants are the people you hang out with, meaning your immediate party and also the people you meet throughout the story. These confidants are really important not only because of the enjoyment factor, but also because they offer you bonuses that will make your life in the palace easier. For example, level up Ryuji at level 6 and you will be able to insta-kill weaker enemies without finding them, and essentially saving you a lot of time if you want to farm. Or if you take the time to rack up Hifumi, you will be able to swap party members on the fly while in battle. An option that you wouldn't have if you didn't take the time to rank her up. Other bonuses consist of stat bonuses and removing debuffs during battle. So, essential confidence will help you in the metaverse immensely, if you take the time to level them up, that is. But that's not the only reason I advise you to get to know them. For the majority of them, these confidants have really interesting stories to tell, and they will give you a lot of backstory and the motivations for each one of them. Not to that, I'm so glad that I get this proper confident again, and you will have to rank him up now. It gave a better insight at his character and motivation, as I said before. And in result, the parts where he is involved in the story are much more intense. Generally, I love all the new confidants. Kansumi is lovable and gives a really interesting bonuses, and Maruki's awkward but charming demeanor makes for some really heartwarming scenes. Also, I think he gives you the best bonuses, so I suggest you rank him up as soon as possible. These were some really nice changes at Royal that made the social life a lot better. Like the new location called Kesijoji, it has minigames and new shops to visit, and I really like spending my time playing darts. Apart from that, some small quality of life additions like seeing what Covenant is available and immediately teleporting to them, or seeing what stat will increase the activity that you're thinking to partake, or allowing you to spend time on LeBlanc even if you have been on a palace that day. It actually made the game feel more fresh to me, even though I had completed the original like 3 times before. The changes may be small, but adding them creates a big domino effect. I thoroughly enjoyed hanging out with these characters once again, and I can't wait to do it all over again at New Game Plus. Speaking of that, there's some new content awaited you as it did with the original game. There's a secret boss to fight again, and oh my god, it's a tough fight. So you better prepare your toughest personas because you're going to need them. So to sum up this review, because it took way too long, and if you're still watching, thank you so much. It takes some determination to hear me rambling for so long. I thoroughly enjoyed Persona 5 Royal in its entirety. I was skeptical about the price at first, but as I was playing through the game, it hit me with so many new improvements and changes that it completely overhauled my whole experience. Also, the third semester was my favorite part of the game, and I think it's worth buying even only for that. My score for Persona 5 Royal is a 10 out of 10, a must have. If you enjoyed this review, make sure to subscribe and like, also tell me what game you want to see next on the channel. And until the next time, have a fantastic day.